There was some rain involved.
Sounds good.
Yeah, but now we're here and we're in the wood, Ron.
Right.
That's where we are.
Oh, are we recording? Oh, yes, yeah.
We're in the Magic Morning Wood.
We're in the wood. Hello, welcome.
Hi.
To the Magic Morning Wood.
Come in.
Here we are.
We're not creepy.
We're feeding deer.
Yes, that's what we're doing.
Bam! I just killed the sacred deer.
That was Bambi's going to be furious. That was
the most joke.
That was a what?
That was Yorgos Nyanthemos.
Ah, very good. Now, if only we shoot that last unicorn,
yes.
We'll be good.
Oh, there's a unicorn. Bam! Got it. Okay, good.
Excellent.
Yes.
So, today, it's my choice here in the wood. We're talking films. We've got a double bill, and I like to think of this as our alternative Marvel Cinematic Universe and DC episode.
Okay.
So, you know, away with you and your fucking boring, well-made bullshit like Captain America and what are the other ones? Avengers and stuff. We're not interested, are we, Ron? I know you are, but pretend you're not.
Right.
There we go. So we've got a Marvel and a DC film.
Yeah, how dare you mix Marvel and DC together?
Of sorts. and we're coming out the gate with, forgive my pronunciation, but I look this up. Uch Dev Adam. What do you think, Ron?
Sure, sounds good to me. I think the Turkish people will probably...
Yes, it's a Turkish film, and I think this translates as basically three mighty men, giant men.
On the IMDb post, it calls it Three Dev Adam.
Yes, three being, I think...
Three being three, I believe.
Yes, but I believe three in Turkish is... Ugh.
Oh, is it? I see. Okay.
Yes. It's you, and then that C with a tail.
Well, what's one and two?
I have no idea.
What kind of research are you doing here?
So, Uch Dev Adam. Possibly.
Uch
Dev Adam, or bootleg title Turkish Spiderman.
I give this film Uch stars out of 10.
Oh, very good. And this is available for you, listener, to view as well, isn't it? It's on YouTube.
Right, yeah.
And it's also on YouTube with English subtitles.
Yeah.
Because the first time I saw this film, it didn't have any subtitles at all.
Yes.
I don't think it actually made much difference to my overall entertainment value, I don't think.
Right.
So this is a Turkish film from 1972. And it's a superhero film, kind of.
Ostensibly.
Yes. And the reason I wanted to talk about this is because it's kind of an interesting variation on, Captain America, Spider-Man, who has a particularly different character in this film.
He's called the Spider. Though.
Spider, yeah.
Yeah.
And El Santo, the Mexican wrestler.
Is that an established character, El Santo?
Oh, yes.
I didn't know that one. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah, El Santo is...
Is that a real person, or like was it a fictional character? Like,
well, that's kind of the interesting thing. El Santo is a Mexican wrestling institution, right? Mm-hmm. El Santo, the saint, right? And he fights in a silver mask.
Right.
And he's one of those interesting guys. He started as just... a wrestler, a masked Mexican wrestler, and then he kind of starred as himself in a series of movies, right? But in real life, he never took off the mask, so no one knew who he was.
Really, even in the shower?
No, absolutely not. He would be sitting there taking a dump with his mask on. Wow. And actually, that's one of the joys.
Commitment.
Yes, one of the joys of the El Santo films, because there's fucking loads of them. There's like, how many would there be? Like, 36 or something.
Really? So he's like Mexico's Elvis.
Yes, apart from totally different. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So he's one of the joys of the films for me is just seeing him do normal everyday tasks, but wearing a mask. For some reason, it's so you see like El Santo like sitting at home
in the movies,
reading the paper or something. Right. Yeah, there's like a great joy to be had for some reason in that. Simple pleasures.
Was it always the same guy, or did they have a series of different actors?
No, I think El Santo was always El Santo. So you asked me the thing about whether he's a real character or a fictional character. He was real, but then he became a fictional El Santo on screen. But then you get the feeling that it was one of those things where fact and fiction kind of blurred a little bit. So I would call him almost like a mythical, I suppose.
Right. But it wasn't like one of those real life people that suddenly like that comic books took and made him into a comic book character. It wasn't like there was like an El Santo Marvel run.
No, but there were El Santo comics.
Oh, there were El Santo comics.
Yeah, so basically he became a hero across all the media. I think there was probably even El Santo radio shows or something.
Okay, because I didn't understand why they chose him. Why choose two Marvel characters and then just rant some random wrestler guy,
right?
So.
Yeah, he is the odd one out. But then again, considering how different they all are from the sources anyway.
Yeah, but I was like, if you're going to choose two Marvel characters, why wouldn't they just choose a third one? That's why I didn't. I'm certainly overthinking this
yes,
movie.
Yes.
But I was just thought those two choices were quite random.
If I were to hazard a guess, I'm guessing it's probably all based on market demands, right? So I'm guessing in Turkey, maybe Captain America is well known, and Spiderman is well known, but maybe a third character wasn't necessarily that famous or well known, and I'm assuming
El Santo really, really famous in Turkey.
I don't know actually, but it could be. I mean, he was huge in Mexico and Spanish-speaking countries, some other territories. It's entirely possible that El Santo took the roof off in Turkey as well. I don't know if Turkey has a big, because it depends where there's a big wrestling scene, I suppose. Right.
Yeah.
So I know, for instance, Japan is a huge wrestling scene, and Japanese wrestling fans are more familiar with Mexican masked wrestlers than other places are, and they came here to do, tours and appearances and things. So it's kind of interesting when you come across this kind of hidden international network that you weren't aware of before, right? Like lots of movies that we've never heard of, like from East Germany and places like that, on the side of the Iron Curtain, they played some territories and became huge hits, right? It's like an alternative history of cinema or something, or cultural kind of. So it's always interesting to come across these things, right? So in this version of the story, and the film hits the ground running, doesn't it? I mean, first scene is Spider-Man and his henchmen putting a woman in a hole in the ground, burying her up to her neck, and then You're looking at me as if you have never seen this before.
I'm waiting for you to finish your explanation.
They push like a boat towards her, right? With the outboard motor propeller thing, and they shove it into her face. It's not gory or anything. You just see blood spraying on a woman's legs, right?
Yeah.
But it's quite a way to kick off a film.
Yeah.
And then
it stiffly sets the scene for Spider-Man being the evil.
Yes, so Spider-Man is a villain in this film.
Not a villain, he's the villain.
Oh yeah, and he's quite nasty.
He has powers that the normal Spider-Man does not have. Like cloning himself after death. And
the ability to stab people with a switchblade.
Yes. Can't do any. Can do no webs, no climbing.
Nothing.
He's just a guy wearing a Spider-Man costume.
Well, it's not even really a Spider-Man costume, is it?
It's like his mom made a Spider-Man costume for Halloween.
The top half is more or less. It's red, but then from the shoulders down, it's green, and he has like a emblem of like a tarantula or something on the front.
Well, I think Spider-Man does have like a spider. Like symbol insignia on his chest, depending on the costume.
But it's not that tarantula. Not
well, it's similar to that, but usually he's also got like the web work.
Yes,
the whole thing.
Yeah,
but it was just like they had bought a Spider-Man costume, or they'd bought something at like a dollar store or something, or someone had just thrown something together.
It's the,
and it's look like the insignia had been like sewn on
Quixote.
In felt.
Spider-Man costume.
But even worse than that, because it looked like the insignia had been sewn on with felt or something. They just made it themselves.
Right. He also has, it's difficult to tell, because again, there's no very good quality version of this film. I don't think it's ever been restored or anything, right? He also either has like bangs that stick out through his eye holes, or really big bushy,
Eyebrows.
Eyebrows. Yeah. I'm hoping it's big bushy eyebrows,
but we'll never know.
No, no. Unless you never know, one day a 4K restoration of Ugh Dev Adam appears.
Ugh.
So he's the bad guy, and he leads a gang of smugglers, isn't he? And
smugglers. Smugglers.
Yeah. Okay. And these smugglers smuggle antiques out. I'm a bit confused, but I think they smuggle antiques out of Istanbul, and then also they buy them back with fake dollars or something. So they make money on...
I really think you're overthinking it.
Something like that.
They're doing something villainous that involves statues, although the statues tend to be just like, obviously, ones that they've picked up on the roadside, but like those like handcrafted like wooden ones that they that you mass market and they sell to tourists. But apparently they're priceless.
Priceless. And this involves Spider-Man. You said he doesn't do any climbing, but he does do a bit of climbing, like because he's a cat burglar, right?
Right,
he's a spider cat burglar,
right?
And he goes up through, but he doesn't do the proper Spider-Man. He just goes up like.
Yeah.
Trellises and things through people's windows.
Yeah.
And strangles a woman in the shower.
Yeah.
Comes across another couple in the shower at one point as well. They're making love or something. And he seems to stab them with a... Like a kebab
knife. Yeah, I don't know what that was. Something. Yeah, so it was like a skewer, of some kind.
Yeah, yeah. So obviously...
And then there's the psycho ripoff where they showed the...
The blood
going into the drain, yeah.
So I also like the bit where... Because also the mafia are after him, I think, because he's muscling in on their territory.
Sure.
So there's a bit near the beginning.
I think you got a lot more than that.
There's a bit where he's being trailed by this mafioso guy.
Right.
And he's like, oh, where did Spider-Man go? And then suddenly he emerges from, he jumps out from like, I don't even know how to describe, he's put like a bunch of planks of wood up against each other, like in a teepee formation or something. And he was up digging. I don't know when he had the time to do this or where he found the wood. And he suddenly bursts out and then stabs the mafia guy, who I know is a mafia because he says, "Adios, mafia." So that's how I know.
Right.
That's what I'm going on.
Right.
So obviously he's bad news, right?
Right, yes, obviously.
So what do you think, Ron? If you have a bad Spider-Man... rampaging through Istanbul, who you gonna call?
Well, obviously you call Captain America and El Santo.
There we go.
Yeah.
Captain America, I mean, without his shield.
It's sort of
yeah.
El Santo without his Mexican, without his Spanish language.
I think El Santo is probably the one who looks closest to.
Yeah,
El Santo.
I guess.
I don't know.
I actually couldn't tell them apart when they weren't in costume.
Right,
He looked very, very similar.
Oh, and Captain America's girlfriend, Julie. Julia, played by Denise Ercanat, who I think might have been a pop star.
Okay.
She's pretty hot, actually. I quite liked her.
Sure.
And Aitekin Akaya is the captain.
Uh-huh.
And
if you will.
Yes. Yavuz Selekman is Santo. And the Spider-Man was played by Tevik Sen. Names to remember.
Great.
So after the kind of hand-drawn opening credits with music stolen from Diamonds Are Forever, the James Bond movie.
Right.
Which I hear a lot of that soundtrack, actually, in films of this era. It seems to have been one of the most ripped-off soundtracks.
Well, interestingly, I mean, this is kind of a little bit off-topic, but...
Go for it.
As I finished the movie, you know, YouTube always, like, send you to the next thing. Mm. So the next thing queued up was a short documentary on the making of the Turkish Star Wars.
Ah, right, okay,
yeah, that was where it just sent me, like, immediately, right? So, and then, so I watched a little bit of that as well, and they talked about how they ripped off the music in the Turkish Star Wars was ripped off from basically just whatever soundtrack LPs
they had lying around.
Yeah. And so there's they have a list of like all the movies that they're that the music, music was taken from. That they just so I think that's probably just what happened is they just happened to have the James Bond LP and then put it on. And,
that,
yeah, on.
That documentary is it the guy? Is it Neon Harbor? Is it the guy from?
I couldn't tell you. I can't remember.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but it was like an English documentary that was. Like, it was like a. It was very short. It was like a 12 or 13 minute.
It
was
seen it, but I think that guy actually recently, the guy who runs a website called Neon Harbor, I think he might have actually managed to get his hands on an original print of the Turkish Star Wars.
Oh, really?
He either has had it restored or is in the process or something like that.
Right.
So he probably knows a bit more about Dev Adam than we do.
Probably,
but,
yes.
Anyway. Yes, so after the credits, El Santo and Captain America arrive in, and Julia, arrive in Istanbul, right?
Right.
They also don't seem massively concerned with having secret identities in this film, either.
No.
Because they just turn up as themselves.
As themselves all the time, so.
And then, even at one point, the captain, like, puts on his costumes while talking to another character.
Yeah, he was, put it on while he was, like, walking down the side of the road. He was, like, walking down the street, and he stops on the side of the road with his costume on.
So there's, like, no...
I gotta put this on.
Yeah, no, I'm Captain America.
Yeah.
It does make you... In fact, at some point, a character, I think, even says... Why do you put those costumes on? And I don't know if it was supposed to be a commentary or a parody, but it was quite a good question. Yeah. I was thinking the same thing.
And I appreciate that they actually addressed the fact that El Santo and Captain America could speak Turkish. They actually addressed that. I thought they were just like just skim over, but they actually said, "Oh, you speak Turkish very well," or something, right? So
Well, you know. Superheroes, that's one of their powers, right? The ability to learn language during a transatlantic flight. They both... Did they come on separate planes? One from Mexico and one from wherever Captain America came from? Washington, I guess?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. See? There's so much in here.
Yeah.
The fan fiction possibilities are endless.
Endless. And
so, it's the Captain and El Santo versus Spider-Man.
But to be fair, they only call him the Spider, not Spider-Man.
Yes, or at least that's what the subtitles say, right? And to be honest, in terms of interest, that's about it.
Yeah.
I think this is one of those things that it occurred to me rewatching it that it's a lot more interesting to know about.
The idea is a lot more interesting than the actual one.
Yeah, because most of it plays out... Well, it's quite boring.
Yeah.
It's not too long. It's like 80 minutes or something, under. So it's not too... It's not international guerrillas territory.
Yeah.
It plays almost like an old serial or something. There's just lots of kind of rushing around and fist fights.
Yeah, lots of fights.
And
lots of fights.
Nothing very superhero-ish.
No.
It perks up a little bit at the end where...
the big climactic battle between Cap and Spider-Man.
Which is in this warehouse.
Yeah, and then he keeps killing Spider-Man and then he clones himself.
I guess. It's very confusing.
I don't know why it is. And suddenly he would appear, like he'd be holding the dead body. I don't know why, first of all, Captain America is killing people.
Right.
And somebody kills Spider-Man, and then he goes, and turns around, and then he's
still right, there.
So it's
there,
like, I don't know, there's some sort of cloning thing happening. I don't know, some...
It's very peculiar.
Yeah. I assume that's a superpower. But...
Yeah, because the Spider-Man, he basically... falls into all sorts of different machinery, right?
Yeah,
or gets run over by a mine cart or something, and then all of a sudden,
And he runs away, and he runs after him, and he does the same thing happens.
Yeah.
And that kind of sequence happens about 7 or 8 times.
And either I forget, or I wasn't actually giving a shit. How did he actually eventually get him in the end?
I forget. It was one of those. Yeah, I can't remember exactly which one was the end one, but finally it just finished, and then he just didn't come back anymore.
And the only other interesting thing is Spider-Man also tortures people, doesn't he?
Yeah.
So there's that scene at the beginning, which, to be honest, is quite nasty, shoving an outboard mortar in someone's face, right?
Yeah.
That's quite notable. And then later on, someone has
skewering people in the shower.
Yes, assume. But there's another scene where.
To be honest, I don't know who any of these people were. Why?
Not he
was
really
killing them. Right? It was
no. It was just a bit random, beyond me.
Random people, right? So
he also attaches, like I suppose it's like an it's like a rip on 1984, I suppose, where he attaches like a long.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah.
What do you call it? A gerbil like walk or tube or something like onto some
with the rats.
Yeah, it's really long. I don't know why it needs to be quite that long.
Yeah, I've seen that was like a medieval torture where they would just put like a just like a mask.
Yes,
and then you know, or with, and then they would just lock it in there. But it was like this giant long. I was like, how do you actually get the rat to go all the way down?
Right,
like what if a rat just wants to just hang out in the tube? Yes. You're holding this tube for the
which they call mice, but I think they were gerbils.
I think they were rats. I think
really,
they
look like gerbils to me.
They were, but I think they were supposed to be rats.
All right,
that's all
right.
What they used,
but they were gerbils. Right?
I think so. Yeah. I think they were like, or they were like a, or they were like a guinea pigs or something.
Right,
I don't know, something like
and they go down. But, and they eventually get to his face.
Yeah,
and
like, oh, well, they said, oh, these have mice have not been fed in a very long time. And so then, then it kind of, like, wanders, like, sort of, like...
Down the tube.
Down the tube along, and it's kind of smelling around, just kind of, and then eventually...
Chew on his face.
You assume, right?
So, well, you see, a bit of blood coming out
right,
the side,
yeah,
right?
Would you assume it's like a chew
but,
on
no, face. It's not particularly graphic.
No, no.
I don't think Turkish films were in general...
No, no, no.
...at this time.
But, yeah, there's a lot of, like, kind of, like... James Bond kind of tortures, you know, like the
yeah,
very elaborate, but
right.
not really use practical.
Directed by one T. Fikret Ülkak, then I'm guessing.
Really?
Yeah.
Just by him?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Written by one Dogan Tamer, who is in the film. He's the guy. He's the main cop liaison guy our heroes meet up with in Istanbul. Yes. And, well, obviously it's fun to know about a Turkish, totally unlicensed rip-off of Marvel characters and El Santo, in which Spiderman is a bad guy with a flick knife. But beyond knowing that, there's not much fun to be had, is there,
on? No, it was pretty, like... I wanted it to be more fun than it was. But, I mean, at least I had... there was moments of amusement, but...
Yeah.
It definitely could have been... They could have done that in, like, a 10-minute short.
Right.
Whatever, so.
And there's some, tame strip numbers as well in a club, isn't there?
Yeah.
To waste some time.
Yeah. A lot of filler.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of filler. And there's a bit of... kind of alleged kind of comedy, like banter between leads, right? Yes, but I think knowing about this and listening
and
to
even,
this...
And even, like, the very, very ending, I thought it was quite funny, where it was almost like one of those, like, old...
Whoa.
It was one of those old cop shows,
yes.
You know, like, where, like, the freeze frame at the very end, where, like, you know, he sees what he thinks is this... the spider one more time in the car and he goes
but
over
it's breath. Some kid, random
guy wearing
slightly backward looking
wearing the mask and then he was like and then they all kind of go freeze, you know, like
right.
It's like,
well,
like
they
freeze in the middle of the laugh, right? You know, like the
as famously parodied in Police Squad, Naked Gun, right?
Exactly, so that type of ending to the movie was, I thought, great.
Right. And, of course, famously parodied by your stage show.
By my own personal stage show.
Yes, there we go.
Yeah.
So I think we both agreed that it's fun to know about, not so much fun to watch.
Right.
Which
but
is what,
I will say,
yeah.
It was way more fun to watch than Bat Pussy.
Oh, right, okay. Hang on, we're going to have a musical break here.
Okay, let's start again. I must have been bit by a spider when I was very small. Now I'm grown up, I spend 5 days a week going up the fucking wall. I must have been fenced into a long State Road when I was 9 or 10. Because now I'm grown up, I spend 5 days a week going round the fucking bend.
Welcome back. So, not that one. But, okay, so this is interesting. We're already at odds here, Ron.
Yeah.
Because whereas I found Dev Adam quite boring, really, mm-hmm. and I suppose I suspected in advance it might be, which is why I did a double bill, because otherwise this would have been like 10 minutes long or something. Bat Pussy. From on the DC side of our, I guess, of our episode, is sublime entertainment of the highest order.
Okay, that actually furthers my theory here, which is that there's actually something seriously wrong with you. I was watching this, but I was like, I think he's actually clinically insane. I think there's really actually something wrong with you, Clive. And I watched this and I was like, and the fact that you actually would consider it something even remotely close to sublime,
yeah,
shows that I think really you need to get some help.
Really? So okay, let's get into this then. So because this is this is my second time watching this, and
oh my gosh,
I could watch it another 5 times easily. Was it tough going, was it?
Okay.
Anyway. All right, so Bat Pussy from, well, we're not quite sure. I wrote it up in my book as a 1973 production, but it might be a little bit earlier than that. And so this is, well, I suppose it's ostensibly a porn film, but it's not. There's no real. I don't think anyone actually properly gets penetrated by anything. So it's.
But you don't really see anything.
No, so it's more like hard softcore. And it's kind of from that weird era when there was kind of crossover where some softcore movies were getting a bit. You know, you'd have the occasional. What they used to call split beaver shots back in the day, before it went hardcore. So it comes from that era. So I don't know if you could properly call it pornography.
I'm not sure if you could properly call it a film.
Oh, shush, Ron. This is the lost Andy Warhol art film. It is very much like one of those, you know, those short Andy Warhol films where they just pointed a camera at someone and waited till they did something. Right. It's all, you know, some people call that art, right?
Sure.
So I don't know.
Some people.
Yes.
Who are those people?
Me. Right, where to start with this? Okay, so yeah, so basically, it's there's a man reading a screw magazine when it was an old like newspaper format thing, right? Uh-huh. So he sat there, and I guess he's probably been drinking a bit as well.
No, you skipped the whole beginning.
Did I?
Yeah, the disclaimer that this is a pornography movie.
Oh right, well, I was gonna get to that later on. Yeah, so. The version that we watched is right. It's like a 50-minute long version, and okay, we'll get to this the wrong way around then. So basically, this film from what I understand,
loosely
shout out
termed,
you fucking Philistine. So this film, as far as I can understand, went possibly maybe even unseen. Until, which I'm sure Ron would have looked to keep
lucky
it
fuckers.
Until, I think it was like the early 90s, someone found it apparently in the back room of some adult movie theater in Memphis, Tennessee, yeah. Right? So they found, and it was just some cans of film with bat pussy scrawled on it. And I think it was sold wholesale to something weird video of Seattle, who are, of course, a huge name in the, you know, cult movie world, responsible for getting lots of amazing stuff out there that I'm going to force Ron to watch over the next few years, and he'll be a better man for it in the end.
Sure.
What doesn't kill you make you stronger, Ron.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
I'm Superman. Oh, I'm Captain America,
yeah,
now.
Yes. And I'm the Spider.
Yes.
So I think this film was kind of discovered. Whether it was actually ever projected at any point, I'm not sure if anyone knows for sure. So anyway, something weird put this out, I think, from the late 90s, like 97, something like that. And this is the version we saw. And when they put it out, they had this series, the Dragon Art Theatre series of double bills, video double bills. And the Dragon Art Theatre was this famous kind of porn theatre that showed these. So it was kind of like, you know, imaginary double bills that may have played the Dragon Art Theatre, right? So each release had this intro, which was by Don Davison, who was a guy who ran the Dragon Art Theatre, and he was also a director. So yes, as you say, he gives us a 1 minute kind of disclaimer, warning.
You're about to see a porn film.
Yes. If, you know, you should be warned that if you don't want to see things of an adult nature, stuff like that, right? Blah, 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 blah. But I'm not sure if this was on the original print, is my point. So it has, Bat Pussy has, this is going to drive you mad, has since been restored. There's an actual, I think they could only get 2K. There's a 2K restoration of it.
So why were we watching
this? On DVD, because I didn't have a copy of the, yeah. I'm not sure if it's going to make a whole lot of difference your enjoyment,
no,
Ron.
I don't think so, yeah.
And there's a commentary as well on the. So I can't wait to get my hands on the new. Sorry, it's not a DVD; it's a Blu-ray.
Oh wow!
Yeah, so I'm going to get you that for Christmas, Ron.
Great.
Bat Pussy Blu-ray.
Great.
And you can watch it with your family on Christmas Day.
That sounds good.
Instead of
my kids will love
fucking
it.
Fantastic Beasts or whatever they watch on Christmas Day nowadays.
What is Beasts?
Yeah. Anyway, so, right, that out the way. So, we open with a man reading screw newspaper at the table, and he's been drinking, I think.
Uh-huh.
And it's in a it's in this room, and there's a bed in the room, and on the bed there's a woman with a beehive hairdo, right? Naked woman with a beehive hairdo.
Uh-huh.
And she's trying to convince him to come to the bed, right?
Okay.
So he sat there drinking his, reading his screw and drinking, and she's saying, come to the bed, come to the bed. And then he gets to the bed, and he's, what do I do first, right? Because they've got very strong southern accents.
Uh-huh.
Apparently, from the 2K restoration, they managed to figure out that the tattoo on him is, I wrote it down, hang on, the Arkansas Razorbacks, which I guess is an American football team.
Okay.
So he might be an Arkansas native.
Right.
And they found the film intensive, but some people seem to think this was a shot in Texas.
Okay.
Film. So anyway, they've got these great southern drawls, right?
Uh-huh.
And he gets to the bed, what do I do first, right? And then I think she might, he might be her pimp.
Okay.
As well as her husband.
Okay.
Because she complains about how he doesn't let her work anymore.
Right.
And he's saying, oh, you know, I don't like you're down there on the corner, blah, 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 blah. So I think he's husband and pimp.
But if he was a pimp, why would he not like her down there on the corner?
It's jealousy, I guess. These two don't strike me as rational people, Ron. I think there may be some drugs or alcohol involved.
I want to know more about the backstory of these characters.
Well, that's, yeah, but
what motivates them?
Fan fiction. Well, yeah. I'll tell you what motivates them is, well...
is disgusting, unwatchable sex.
It's great, isn't it? So, yeah, so basically, he gets on the bed, and then the short version of it is they proceed to argue and swear and abuse each other for the length of the film while attempting... Well, I don't think he actually gets hard properly once, does he? She's like there sucking away on his wet noodle and they go 69. Uh-huh. And I was keeping an eye on... I don't think he ever actually gets properly erect.
Well, she was pretty gross.
Oh, Ron. You mean fellow. You don't like her beehive hairdo?
All right, continue.
Right. So, yeah. And
your expedition is longer than the movie. So.
Yeah, well, the thing is, it's very difficult to distill what's so awesome about this film. I'm having difficulty kind of summing up, but it is fucking brilliant. Like, it's so good. I can't believe you didn't enjoy this film.
I can't understand why you would. Let me distill it. Let me summarize.
All right, okay, go for it.
Okay, so these two
rednecks, let's go there,
douchebags decided they're going to
have... I don't know if they're douchebags. They've...
Excuse me, this is my summary.
Okay, go for it.
Decided they're going to have sex, but it's but while they're doing it, they're just annoyingly yelling at each other through the whole time, and it's not really good sex. It's just sort of like this kind of rough.
It's not even sex.
It's not even really sex. It's just this like writhing, like unwatchable, like just I don't even know what it was supposed to be, and then they're just yelling at each other for like probably 25 minutes, just
so
yelling
good.
While they're doing it. And I was just, shut up. I even like yelled, it's like, shut up.
Really?
He was like, shut up.
I want a 2-hour director's cut.
And then suddenly...
Hang on, we'll get there.
No, that's like, this is like half the movie right there. That's
no, we haven't finished with these two yet.
No, that's it. That's all they do. Is they,
no,
this,
no, no.
This unwatchable, no, like, gross, disgusting, like, was it even sexy? Like,
their dialogue is awesome. Because she's pissed off at him because he's cheating, right? I guess.
Yeah.
And he's pissed off because he's like, do it like in the magazine! Do it like in the magazine! He keeps wanting to do it like in the magazine, right? And she's like, you fucking motherfucker cheating on me with all them fucking other... And it's just an endless barrage of just fucking spitting at each other, and then it, suck, you can't suck no fucking dick. It's just... I think I might have to edit in snippets of dialogue, because sure. I can't do it justice. This endlessly quotable dialogue.
I guessed that that the dialogue was the reason why you chose this movie.
Right.
But it was, I just found it just, like, fingernails in a shot. It was just so irritating to me.
Oh, really?
What they were saying, yeah.
Well, when I say dialogue, I mean just random shit they've come up with.
Like, barrage of insults at each other.
It's, I mean, honestly, I had such a good time. Some of the ones I wrote down, because some of them are borderline surreal, right?
Right.
One of my favorites is, every time I run my tongue up your pussy, it comes out your fucking asshole. Now, what kind of deal is that? Brilliant. And my absolute favorite is, my horoscope said, fuck you in the nose. Brilliant. And he mentions fucking her in the nose. Sorry, there's another one I like as well. Yeah. Hi. We booked the room. We're recording in here.
Recording?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Until when?
Until 2. We're room booked until 2.
All right.
Thanks.
Have fun.
Cheers. That was Captain America.
Yeah, Captain America came in.
From Ichdev Adan.
Right.
Yeah, my other favorite one was, I'm going to suck your pussy till your head caves in. I tell you, what Aaron Sorkin couldn't come up with stuff this good.
Right.
Watching
you talk about it is way more entertaining than the movie itself.
Okay, anyway. Yeah, so that's only half the story run. Because then we cut to Bat Pussy Secret Hideout.
Right.
Which is a shack out in the middle of nowhere, I guess. And Bat Pussy, a.k.a. Dora Dildo, is her super senses, her twat begins to twitch, to quote the film, because someone's about to shoot a fuck movie in her beloved Gotham City, right? Dirty motherfuckers. So she's furious. Bat Pussy is furious, right? So she puts on her Bat Pussy outfit and jumps on her space hopper. For those of you, I don't know if people still have space hoppers, do they?
I don't even know what a space hopper is.
Oh, really? Well, that thing she's on, which is like a... Did you not have one of these?
The guy?
No, there's like a... It's like a... what do you call it?
Oh, that was like a joke. Come on.
Inflatable...
The thing that she was on.
Inflatable... It's a, what do you call it? Like a medicine ball looking thing, but it has like gears, right?
Yeah,
so you grab on and you can...
We called it just like an exercise ball or whatever those are.
But don't you have special ones for kids with like those gears?
Yeah, it wasn't called a space hopper. I don't remember what it was called. It was like a pogo ball or something.
Right. Yeah, so she's furious. She's heading... Mm-hmm. So she bounces on her space hopper across... Texas, I guess, across down the highway. She pauses to stop a rape at one point, and she has a piss as well. But otherwise, she's just bouncing. And while she's bouncing, as if this film couldn't... I was already, like, in my element. I was watching this, and I was just fucking... Oh, I hope Ron likes this, because I think this is just... Oh, this is so good, right? But then, when she goes on a space hopper... We also get an awesome rock instrumental, right? Did you like this piece of music, at least?
Sure.
You like that?
No.
Oh, you didn't? That's good. This is by Neil Hefti, which is the guy who...
I already checked out, so...
Who wrote the Batman theme tune.
Right.
Apparently he was a trumpeter, jazz composer, arranger. Oh, okay. And there's an album, which is the Batman theme tune, and 11 other Bat-tastic... themes or something, and apparently this track is from that. It's called Sewer Lady. Yes. And I thought it was awesome. Anyway, sorry. And then so we go back and forth between Bat Pussy and the couple who are still arguing. Uh-huh. He's now criticizing her blowjob technique. She's criticizing his clam lapping, mm-hmm. right? They're both inadequate. And I think they mentioned at some point that they have two children as well, which is another interesting mm-hmm. element for the fan fiction.
Right.
And finally, Bat Pussy arrives. Uh-huh. So what do you think happens then? Well, you know what happens. You tell what happens. There's this huge, you know, oh my God, she's finally arrived. They're shooting a fuck film in her beloved Gotham City. How does she go about stopping this crime?
More gross, unwatchable sex.
Yes, pretty much. He goes, it's a misunderstanding. It's a misunderstanding. And then she just jumps on the bed. And then he strips her off. And they roll around and complain to each other. More swearing, more motherfuckers, more. At one point,
it's just like writhing. It's like it was just like they're just like grinding on a bed, but there's you couldn't see it. There's nothing
right.
sexy or
no,
fun,
no.
or it was just the it was just like this, like
yeah.
pulsating flesh moving around. For,
if,
like
if anyone know. Has successfully jerked off to Bat Pussy, I would applaud them. I mean, it would be a pretty impressive.
There's nothing like remotely like arousing about this movie at all.
Maybe if you've been imprisoned for 30 years, maybe. And this is the first thing you saw when you got out.
Yeah, maybe, I guess.
At one point, she falls Dora Dildo Bat Pussy, or as the guy keeps calling her, Bat Pussy, he keeps correcting it. She falls off the bed and he lands on her head as well at one point, which is quite exciting.
Right.
And you occasionally hear the crew members.
Right.
Like, there's like one guy who like belches really loudly. And then sometimes they stop and take prompts as well, don't they, off camera. You can see them, like, they stop and they go, what? yeah. And then it ends.
Yeah, that's it.
50 perfect minutes. I mean, seriously, I know you think I'm taking the piss, but I'm not. I genuinely, because as well, we should put it in the viewer's mind, although you should really see it for yourself. It's the camera doesn't really move either, right? It's pretty much it is seriously, it is like those Warhol films.
Yeah.
It's like, but I really didn't have a good time with this, like even a little bit.
I really don't understand why you would. Like, really? Really, explain to me, what is it that you love about this movie?
Well, I think that's what I've just been doing. I don't know how much further. I mean, if I hear someone else telling me this, uh-huh. I would immediately have to.
But I think the way you put it sounded interesting. That makes me want to see a movie that wasn't the movie that we watched. It was just.
Oh, really?
Really?
You think it's all in my head?
Oh yeah, I really do. Yeah.
But then again, I'm not the only one though. I mean, this film does have a cult following now.
I'm sure it does, more
so now than I think when I first saw it. When I first saw it, it fucking knocked me sideways because I didn't really know anything about it. It was a total random watch and Bat Pussy. Okay, the cover looks kind of interesting.
Right.
And I was like, oh my God, this is just awesome. This is like, wow. And I haven't been in a position to push it on anyone before. But if this is the reaction, I'm wondering.
Maybe I'm the outlier. Maybe I'm the crazy one, you know.
So there was nothing, because I could understand someone like having enough after 50 minutes.
Yeah.
But what you're saying is you didn't even like get a modicum of kind of charm out of it.
Nothing,
even for like a minute.
Not a little bit, no.
You didn't even get off
after
on
they started like I got really irritated when they was yelling at each other at the beginning, and I was like, this is not even like this doesn't even work as a porn film. I don't really know, like they're just irritating and it's not sexy or arousing. It's just like really annoying,
really
like, awful people. And then it was like this other person who was ostensibly in a bat person costume that she just took off almost immediately, and she was on a pogo ball for some reason, and then it was like more just unwatchable sex. And I was like, well, I just didn't understand what was it there was to like about it. So,
all right,
I thought it was just another one of your like trying to get me to watch nonsense
again. No. I'm genuinely nonplussed by your reaction. I mean, at this stage in the game, I realize that you might not necessarily as been as fanatical about it as I am.
Right.
But I honestly did think you would get a kick out of it.
Oh, really?
But you just seem totally. So you found these two irritating.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Very, oh, really? Yeah, really strongly irritating. So.
Strongly
oh,
irritating,
wow.
Yeah.
Because I found them much... don't get me wrong, I'm not saying I'd want to be their neighbours. But to watch them from a... Just watch them, I found them utterly charming.
Really?
Like, my God, these people are... Like, I didn't know what the
charming?
Fuck... Charming? Really? I wouldn't know what the fuck they were going to say next. They were just such a... I seriously could have watched a two-hour version of this and I wouldn't have got bored. yeah.
Wow. Okay. Well,
okay.
Maybe I'm the crazy one. I'm.
No. I mean, it would be interesting if I would like to. It would be interesting to screen this, like to a room of people and see how many walkouts you'd get. Or but then again, I suspect
variations of reactions.
You were saying that you were enjoying watching me get off on explaining it more than watching the film.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, if you were to watch it in a room full of people and there was like someone in there enjoying it, I'm wondering if that would be more infectious.
Yeah, it's quite possible.
Maybe.
Yeah. I mean, watching it, the context which you watched something may have something to do with it. Like, how did you watch it in the first place? By yourself, or?
Yes, but then again, as we've established, there's something wrong with me.
Yeah.
But no, I'm wondering if it would work. Let's say, for instance, if you put it on like in a bar or something, like in a, you know, you just put a projector out and people were just having a good time and drinking and you'd have one or two people who really enjoyed it. I can imagine it would work. Maybe.
Yeah, I probably would enjoy it if it was like a community atmosphere thing with people yelling and shit and whatever.
Right.
I mean, that might be, you're enjoying more the
it's the next
situation than the film itself.
It's the next Rocky Horror.
Yeah, sure.
Bat
yeah,
Pussy.
Yeah.
With people up on stage mimicking
in their costumes.
Yeah. Mimicking the action exactly. Dirty motherfucker. Okay. Well, there we go. I failed in putting some high culture into your life again,
yes.
Ron.
Sorry again. Sorry to disappoint you yet again.
So if you were strapped down and forced to watch one of these again, it would be Uchtev Adam then?
Well, I guess so.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Because for me, it's Uchtev Adam. I don't think
although, to be honest, if I was strapped down and forced to watch one again, I'd probably watch Bat Pussy again. One, because it's shorter.
Right.
And two, because maybe I would enjoy it more now that I've seen your enthusiasm for it.
It could be.
Right.
Because for me, I've no desire to watch Ich, Dev, Adam again.
I don't think I'd want to watch that again.
But Bat Pussy, I could make it a regular...
Out of curiosity, did you watch it with your wife?
No, actually. I don't think she'd enjoy it.
No,
Because I think you'd have to... Your English comprehension would have to be, like, well, she might just not enjoy it at all, you did. But then even if you were prone to... I think you'd have to be... I think you may have to be an English native speaker, because then you'd fully get, because it's not about what they say, it's how they say it or why they say it or how some of it is non-secular. Do you know what I mean? In the same way as comedy doesn't necessarily translate.
Right.
In fact, even if someone, so scratch that about the English, even if someone speaks English really, really well, so it's not to do with comprehension, sometimes humour doesn't translate.
Right.
So I think it's the humour here. But then again, on the other hand, I might sling it on one night when we're drunk, and she might enjoy it. And then we may reenact Bat Pussy.
Right.
And then I'll call you up, and you can
hop
across the city on your space hopper.
Nice.
So there we go. That's our alternative. So next time you're thinking, on the one hand, oh, I fancy watching Avengers Infinity War again. No. Uchtev Adam, And, you know, rather than Batman versus Superman Dawn of Justice or something.
No one wanna watch that again.
Exactly. So
Dark Knight. The Dark Knight. So the Dark Knight you watch.
Or Bat-Pussy, right, yeah. Which is, you know, I'm sure Christopher Nolan's got a remake in the works.
Right, yeah. So,
so there we go, that's us for this time.
Right, yes.
Glad you enjoyed, Ron.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. Yeah, thanks for...
Yeah. Good times in the wood, as always.
Yeah.
And
there's a very good chance that if I lick your pussy, my tongue might come out your asshole.